Since we're at a presidential library, it seems appropriate to begin our program with some comments about the importance of the Navy from some former presidents of the United States. George Washington said to the Marquis de Lafayette in 1781, "It follows, then, as certain as that night succeeds the day, that without a decisive naval force we can do nothing definitive, and with it everything honorable and glorious." In 1902, Teddy Roosevelt said, "A good navy is not a provocation to war. It is the surest guarantee of peace." And finally, in 1963, on board the USS Kitty Hawk, John Kennedy said, "Events of October 62, meaning the Cuban Missile Crisis, as they had all through history, that control of the sea means security. Control of the sea can mean peace. Control of the sea can mean victory. The United States must control the seas if it is to protect your security." And now to introduce our speaker, it's a pleasure to invite the former commanding officer of the Michigan ROTC unit, Rick Vandenhoevel.
Well, good evening, everybody. We're extremely honored to have as our guest tonight Captain John Meier. He's in our great state, obviously, to support the ship that he commands, which is the namesake of Gerald R. Ford. And it's CVN 78, for those of you who keep track of all the numbers. The USS Gerald R. Ford is the first in the line of a new class of aircraft carriers. It's going to have more capability, more capacity than any aircraft carrier that's on the sea today. Okay? And as a former aircraft carrier sailor myself, it's one of those situations where just the fact that the Gerald R. Ford is underway and at sea is going to change world events. And it's going to change world events just, again, by the fact that she is there, that the ship is off the coast somewhere. Now, you can read Captain Meier's bio at your leisure, but suffice to say, he's a winter native. He's raised in Pennsylvania, so he's well used to the snow, but I'm glad to see you got your snow blizzard driving qualification while you were here. He's a 1986 graduate of the United States Naval Academy. He flew the EA-6B Prowler and has accumulated, he's now nuclear-trained aviator. He's got over 4,000 aircraft hours and 675 aircraft arrested landings, carrier arrested landings. This is the second time that Captain Meier has been in the state promoting the Gerald R. Ford, and we're very, very glad that you were able to swing through Ann Arbor this time to be able to speak to us today. We also want to thank you for bringing your wife, Rachel. I'm glad she was able to join you on this trip. And the awesome sailors that you've got with you, because they're terrific. It is our privilege and our honor to have you here. And ladies and gentlemen, Captain John Meier.
Thanks, sir. Thank you. Well, good evening. It's great to see that everybody was able to brave the weather. I've gotten my share of cold weather, snow and ice here. We had a foot and a half of snow out there in Grand Rapids, and the story was when we were leaving Grand Rapids today, everybody said, all you got to do is get about 20 miles east and the roads will be clear, there'll be no snow, but I think we drug it with us, clearly. But it is absolutely back, great to be back in the state. I want to talk about a couple things. First, it is great to finally visit the library here. Elaine made a comment that really just struck me as you were saying it. And John Kennedy in 1963, during the Cuban Missile Crisis on the USS Kitty Hawk, was commenting about naval power, naval aviation and the naval power. The enduring aspect of the aircraft carrier made that ship as relevant and capable as it was the day I commanded VAQ-136 on that ship in 2005. When you just said that, that's pretty impressive to me. So there it was in 1963, and then in 2005, there it was when I was doing my CO tour on a VAQ squadron, VAQ-136. It reminds me of the one question that I think every president has asked in time of crisis, and certainly President Kennedy asked it, and he was even on board the ship during the Cuban Missile Crisis, but that is, Where are the aircraft carriers? That happens all the time. Far too often, unfortunately, I think, in our world, but it happens. And it's not too terribly long before Gerald R. Ford is ready to answer that call with Gerald R. Ford stands ready, awaiting your orders, Mr. President. I like to talk about the ship, and I'll talk to you about the ship in a moment. I love to talk about the crew and my philosophy about the command. So we'll touch on a couple of those things. But first, I wanted to start with one of the aspects that got my attention right out of the gate. There are a couple things. There's been a lot of big milestones with the development of this ship. Susan Ford actually welded on the keel of this ship back in 2009, fall of 2009. And we're on track to deliver the ship or commission her in March of 2016. So that's about roughly a seven-year construction process. There's going to be about a two and a half year process of training for the crew and the ship and the integrated training, very complex a level of training. That means that the ship won't deploy until 2019. That's a 10-year process from the start of that construction process to sending her into harm's way and to answering the president's call as a ready, fully trained aircraft carrier. So one of the things we did that was exciting is we landed the island on board the ship. And we did that before I was even there as the commanding officer, but I was up in Nuke School getting a refresher in DC. And so I'd been to Nuke School once and they had sent me back up there for about 3 months to teach me all about the new reactors on board Gerald R. Ford. And I got a call and they told me that I had to come down to Newport News as we're going to land the island. And if you know anything about tradition in the Navy, it used to be a tradition in the old sailing ships that before they landed the mast on the ship, that COs would put coins underneath the mast as a symbol of luck. Well, we don't do that anymore exactly, but it is tradition that an aircraft carrier, that the first commanding officer gets to put their wings underneath that island. So on a very cold day in February, Newport News, I put my wings under there. Susan Ford Bales, our sponsor, put some coins and mementos underneath the island, and they landed the island on there and crushed that kind into the deck. The dirty little secret is they scoop that stuff up, really, because if you leave it there, it'll become a corrosion problem. It's really that means. But then they scoop it up and they put it in a little time capsule and they weld that time capsule into the foundation of the island. And every time I go up there, I show people around the ship a lot and I'll kind of show them, hey, see this time capsule right here? My wings are in there. And that captured it before I even showed up to the ship. And it really started me on this quest for, okay, how are we going to do this? We're starting from scratch. And I'll get into that, and I'll probably weave that into all my comments today. But one of the things that we did early on, too, is we designed this patch. And this is kind of the ship's patch, and I'm partial to it. If you ask me, I'll tell you it's the best of all the carriers out there. And it's not just me designing, it's not just Ships Force. It was a collaborative effort with us and our sponsor, Susan Ford Bales. So you notice the stars around here, there are 38 stars signifying President Ford being the 38th president. 26 of these are gold. Those represent CVL 26, the USS Monterey, the light carrier that President Ford served on as navigator during World War II. Obviously, the ship is central to the theme, and the ship is the island that's further back, and it's got a unique design, but it's generally the same as a Nimitz-class carrier. As I tell folks, the things that are different is a long, long list. The things that are the same are pretty easy. It's still flat on the top. That really helps in landing aircraft on it. And the hull is exactly the same as the Nimitz-class hull. So those two things are the same. I'll tell you virtually everything else inside the ship is different. We have President Ford's signature. You notice is centered right over the Michigan, the state of Michigan. We have a compass on there. And the compass is topped with a fleur-de-lis indicating true north for the Boy Scouts. And I keep a list with me, and I think I'm going to keep this with me all the time now, because I've gone back and I've done a lot of research, and I continue to learn more. That's why it's so nice to be here to the library, to really learn more about the man. But I wanted to list a few attributes. Trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, and kind. I think of that, and I think of every person I've wanted to have as a friend. I think of that, I think of my spouse. I think of the folks that I've wanted to work for. And you know what that is? That's the Boy Scout credo, if you will, back in the day when President Ford was a Boy Scout. And he wasn't just a Boy Scout, he went on to be an Eagle Scout. And I find it, I don't know if it's ironic or an indictment on the way things are today, but to refer to somebody as a Boy Scout today is a pejorative. I read that list of attributes, and I think just the opposite. I want to surround myself with Boy Scouts. Those are the people that are my friends, those attributes, those qualities. And I think that that really is kind of the life of President Ford. So the compass topped with the fleur-de-lis represents those values to us, and the compass aligned, obviously, to True North, we refer to it as our moral compass. And I think it's important that we know where our True North is with our moral compass, and we align it regularly. And then integrity at the helm really joins us with the Ford Foundation. So we ask the Ford Foundation, and with their permission, we share the same logo, if you will, on our patch. And integrity and the values that President Ford lived in his life, that's what we have built our crew around. And I'll probably come back to that, but Kate, if you would roll the slides will kind of go through some carriers, I think, and some sailors and some of the stuff we're doing, but I'll talk to you a little bit about the ship and some of the incredible advancements in the ship and some of the challenges that we have and what I think is our approach to how we do that at Gerald R. Ford. So the technology is impressive. It is absolutely state-of-the-art technology. I think our Navy and our nation made a bit of a stretch, because normally when you have this much new technology, you would incrementally roll that out on a series of different ships. And on Ford, we've done it pretty much all on one ship, a whole lot of new things. We have completely new reactor design. The A-1B reactors, brand spanking new. The shore-based test facility doesn't exist. The first operational reactors are going to be right there on board Gerald R. Ford. So the reactor department that's on board testing and operating the plant right now has the great responsibility of being the first to take those plants operational. Pretty exciting stuff. The catapults in the arresting gear are completely redesigned. We used to use steam for that. Now we use electrical linear motors. Some great advantages to that. They use shared energy distribution throughout the ship. They have an ability to self-correct for deviations in speed and deviations in airflow that we never had before with the steam system. And the system works. It exists up in Lakehurst, New Jersey right now. I've talked to the test pilots. It gives a much smoother linear acceleration to the aircraft instead of kind of a real bang or shot in the back when you do the steam catapults. That should be easier on the aircraft, both launching for the EMALS, that's the electromagnetic aircraft launching system, or landing for the advanced arresting gear, which is the new arresting gear system, which is completely redesigned as well. So it used to be a hydraulic ram system with cables spun back and forth, and now it relies on a device called a water twister, which you can kind of think of as a paddle wheel, an electrical motor, which provides resistance and a mechanical brake in series. We have brand spanking new radar on board. The dual band radar consists of the SPY 3 and the SPY 4 radar, two phased arrays on each third of the island. It's essentially eliminated rotating radars on board the island, so it gives a very unique look to the superstructure. And it also provides the most capable radar in the water, more capable than the current Aegis that we have today. So we have a tremendously capable radar, state-of-the-art launching system, state-of-the-art reactor plants with a better design that will last at least 25 years between fueling, and a ship design that from the outset is designed to reduce manpower, reduce work, to make parts and components last longer. So if you look at how she's built, there's a lot fewer parts and valves to have to maintain. An example of that is on Ford, instead of having four aircraft elevators, we have three. Instead of having three hangar bays, we have two. So you've shrunk the number of pieces, major pieces of equipment. Therefore, you've reduced the amount of work. We've taken the novel concept of storing the food that we've served to the crew right underneath the kitchen. What a great idea. Before, we kept the bombs underneath the kitchen, which was not a very good idea, because then when you pull the bombs out, you had to move them through the kitchen, and you couldn't serve food. Now we've got special weapons transfer areas that and different places where we keep the ordnance, but the food's right underneath there, so it's very easy to load the food right below the kitchen. When it comes time to feed people, you break it right out, right into the kitchen, and you have a common kitchen much like a lot of restaurants, you have one restaurant, if you will, or one galley, and it serves the chiefs, the wardroom, and the enlisted folks right from the same kitchen. So for the Navy veterans, it used to be that the chiefs would always, they'd always snipe the best cooks. There's no doubt about it. They'll tell you they didn't do that, but they did that. And so they had really good food. And the rest of us kind of got the best of what was left over. There's no argument anymore that the same people are making the food for all the folks. So that's a big improvement. We have new advanced weapons elevators on board the ship, so that same technology of linear motors that we use to launch the aircraft, we do in the vertical axis now for moving our ordnance around. Those elevators move at twice the rate of speed. They have twice the capacity for moving ordnance. And the design of the flight deck is vastly improved as well. So we now have weapons elevators that open up in the middle of the flight deck. We have fueling stations and electrical stations that open up or port right out of the flight deck to the aircraft. So this design was kind of based on a NASCAR concept. So if you know anything about NASCAR, you kind of pull into a pit stop and, you know, a bunch of folks climb all over the car and fuel it and fix it and all that sort of thing. Similar concept. We don't do it quite that fast, but a similar concept is streamline that flow. And by moving the island further aft on the ship, you've created a lot more real estate. And what I would tell you is that prime real estate, that area forward of the island, is a big open area for refueling, rearming, and doing some minor maintenance and getting those aircraft back in the air. And as a result of all that, we've increased our ability to do what we call sortie generation on the ship, which is the amount of sorties that we can generate over a given period of time. Those improvements are all impressive. The quality of life improvements on the ship are spectacular. If you talk to our sailors, and I do, they will tell you some great things. It's easy for us to kind of glom onto some of the creature comforts, if you will, but if you talk to the sailors, the things that they love are the ease of maintenance. So if you used to work on an old weapons elevator, those things are nasty, dirty, hydraulic, greasy, extremely labor-intensive, hard to get to, and a lot of corrosion. What are they now? Just the opposite. It's an electronic linear motor. It's got great diagnostics. It's got computer systems that tell you when components are failing or having issues or problems. Much more easy to operate, much more easy to maintain. And we expect it to be much, much more reliable as a direct result of that. Sailors love that. Electricians on board the ship will have to do work periodically on the ship, and we have, if you've ever been on an aircraft carrier, it's not kind of like walking down the hallway of a building, because we seem to put all of our electrical fixtures and hang them on the walls, and there's all this stuff hanging in the way. Well, that's by design, so in case we have to work on things for damage control or fire, we have very ready and very easy access to that. Well, on this ship, the hallways are wider. Well, you might think that's great, but you talk to an electrician, you know why it's great? Because now they have a good margin of safety around that electrical work. They can cordon that off safely. They can operate safely and create the right margin of safety, not only for themselves, but for others, and they don't have to close off a whole passageway on board the ship. Same issue with the hydraulic cleanliness as far as the resting gear mechanisms go. Much cleaner, much neater to operate. You talk to sailors about the berthings, which is a creature comfort. The berthings on carriers now, some of them are as big as 220-person berthings. So if you can manage a 220-person locker room, but you don't have a bathroom where you sleep, you kind of got to put on a robe or some sweatpants and go down the hallway and find one that is accessible to everybody else on the ship. It may not be as clean as you would like it if it was your own personal bathroom and you're sharing it with however many hundreds of your closest friends. I think one of the best designs on the ship are the smaller berthings that we have. So we have many more berthings. They're much smaller. The average size of the berthing is somewhere in the 20 to 30, 28 to 32 range. So if you can imagine a much smaller berthing, 28, 32, your closest friends, and you have your own shower and your own head attached to your own berthing. So no longer do you have to put on a robe, go down the hallway, and what have you. And if you talk to our female sailors, which make up 22% of the crew, they love that. No longer do they have to put on a robe and cross across the mess decks or whatever. It's right there for them, and it's theirs. And we're also doing something on Ford that, this is something we're doing, is we're putting key cards on there. For a long time, we've done that for the officers, that they had their own individual staterooms and their own key cards. Well, we're treating the enlisted berthing spaces the same way we treat an officer's enlisted or an officer's stateroom, that you're going to have your own key to your own room. So that head that's in there is yours. It doesn't mean that everybody in the ship can come traipsing through your berthing to go use that. It is yours. And that pride and ownership is going to make for a cleaner, better quality of life without a doubt. Because I think we all know if it's yours, you take better care of it, right? If that 1,500 of your sailors or your closest friends are sharing that head, maybe you don't want to clean it quite as much. So I think that's going to help a lot. So those are kind of the ship things. And I will tell you all that's neat. The challenge, though, on board Ford is how do you build the crew? And that's really, you know, the technology's fantastic, I will tell you. But we haven't yet created a ship that sails itself or maintains itself. And even things like unmanned aerial vehicles, you know, the drones of the day. Anybody who thinks that they're unmanned, you don't know what you're talking about. You know, when you put unmanned aerial vehicles on an aircraft carrier, you know how many people come with that? The X-47 demonstrator came with 140 people. That's not unmanned. The only thing that's unmanned is the fact there's not a person in the cockpit. There's still a whole lot of maintenance. You still have pilots that are flying electronically on board the ship and that sort of thing. So how you build the crew is enormously important. And this is really where I started. I had some time after I found out that I was selected to be the first CEO of Ford, and I had some time to start working on this aspect. And I started doing research on Gerald Ford. And I read a few of his books. I just reread Young Gerald Ford on the way here, which was fun because I had the opportunity to go out to Old South High School in Grand Rapids and see where he went to school. And that is now the South High School Job Corps building. Pretty impressive. But you know, if you look at Gerald Ford's life, it is salt of the earth. Absolutely salt of the earth. You talk about good, hardcore Midwestern values. And as I think more about it, the more I learn about Gerald Ford, the more the values that are Michigan values, I think, are very much in line with what I grew up in Western Pennsylvania. Hard work, respect, dignity, trust, do your best. If you're doing something, if you're gonna put your name on it, make sure you did it right. I love that. The way the folks in this state and this community give back, I had the opportunity to speak to the Lions in Grand Rapids and the Rotary Club here. People that are generous with their time and their spirit, and their word is their bond. I love that. So what I would tell you is if you have sons and daughters, send them to Gerald R. Ford. I'd love to have them. Because every Ford sailor that is from Michigan on check-in, I immediately get pulled down a conversation about that's where our namesake's from. And I start to talk about some of the great values that Gerald Ford exhibited throughout his life. So like I said, Boy Scout, Eagle Scout, standout football athlete there at South High School. Obviously goes on to the University of Michigan where he excels at the University of Michigan. Stories about the character of his life throughout abound. Graduates, goes on to coach, goes to Yale and works some coaching at Yale and finagles a way to also go to law school. And when Pearl Harbor happens, Gerald Ford raises his hand, swears an oath to support and defend the Constitution and goes off to war. It's impressive. That's not lost on me because some of this generation have done essentially the same thing post 9/11. And occasionally I'll get a sailor that'll check in that tells me that's why they joined the Navy. But President Ford goes off and serves with distinction. And I've talked to three of the survivors of the Monterey, three surviving crew members, veterans from World War II, and I will tell you, I love this conversation. It was last November at the christening. Three of the survivors from the Monterey were there at the christening ceremony. They're pretty old. They're not getting around very well. They're wheelchair bound. And I'll tell you, I came over and I talked to them, and all three of them rose up out of their wheelchair, shook my hand, looked me in the eye, and they told me that Gerry Ford saved my life in reference to a terrible fire that happened on board that ship in the middle of a typhoon when an aircraft got dislodged in the hangar bay and President Ford was ordered to leave the bridge and to go lead the fire team in the effort to save the ship. I love that story. As you think about how you build a culture and a crew, service to country, great core values, courage under fire and courage on fire. And then after the war, President Ford goes on to serve law, runs for office, long-term representative in the western part of the state, selected to be vice president because he was such a man of character, and who would have thought 9 months later he was president. He didn't seek the office at the time, but he served it with great distinction. And I think no finer words have been said about President Ford, in my opinion, than when Tip O'Neill eulogized him and said that he was the president that we've always wanted, but we didn't know we had. And I think that history has been very kind to President Ford, and I think as folks recognize that his character was superb, that's kind of exactly what we want in our lives and what we want in our leadership in this country. So I've tried very hard to make that culture a part of Gerald R. Ford, to make his life an attribute of Gerald R. Ford sailors. And I want to tell you a little bit about how we do that. Because if you know anything about business or the Navy, or I would argue any organization that you're aware of, one of the first challenges is, how do you get new people, new employees? And I don't think it matters whether you work at Pizza Hut or whether you work for the archives. You know, somebody, you hire somebody, what do you need to do? You need to get them into your culture, right? You need to inculcate that person into the culture of your organization. And how you do that is a challenge. And last I checked, I don't know if there's an instruction book for that. So in our case, here's how we do it. We immediately start an indoctrination program when a sailor checks into the command. So we get orders on them. We have a sponsorship program, so we get orders. We find out that they're coming, and we reach out to them. We try to make contact, and we are very successful at making contact before they ever come to the command. We get them to fill out paperwork for security badges and computer accesses. So if we do it right, they walk in the door, and we're waiting for them. Their badges are done or just a moment away from being done. Their computer access is done. We get them in front of their leadership immediately. As soon as we can, one-on-one, one-on-two. Our chief petty officers, very, very engaged in that. As are our most junior sailors, like Airman Garrett. Because if it's just the commanding officer's words, and the chiefs don't reinforce that, if the young airmen don't reinforce that, somewhere in that chain of command it breaks down and it doesn't happen. So we get our arms around our sailors quick. We welcome them with open arms. When we're living on board the ship, not only will we welcome them with open arms, we'll make their racks. And if they're real junior sailors, we do make their racks. We make their beds for them in Huntington Hall. What other command does that? I don't think anybody does. And you know what? I didn't order anybody to do that. What a great way to welcome somebody. And you know that old adage, you only get one chance to make a first impression, or you don't get a second chance to make a first impression? Something like that rings true. So we go through that indoctrination process. We have a two-week class that our sailors go through, a two-week class of indoctrination that is all about the history of our namesake. It is about the programs, the safety, the damage control, about how we do business at Ford, about the organizational structure. We have basically every organization or entity come in, from our legal department, from our media department, Command Master Chief, Executive Officer. And when we're through that, if not sooner, those sailors get to sit down with me in a one-on-one, I say one-on-one, but one-on-one, one-on small group type of an organization or meeting. Sit down with them, about eight of us. Generally, sometimes it's eight sailors, I won't go more than 10, and we have a conversation. And the conversation is just that. It's not me spouting off to them or espousing things, and I certainly don't spend a heck of a lot of time telling them what not to do, because I've seen that. I spend my time getting to know the crew, because one of the things I've learned in my time in the Navy is that the more you know about the people that work for you, the better leader you will be, the better boss you will be, the better supervisor you'll be. And this doesn't apply to the commanding officer, it applies to the chief petty officers. So the chief knows probably more about the sailors in his charge than I do about the folks, but that's kind of the way it's supposed to work. But that makes him a better chief petty officer. So we sit down, we have a conversation. Our conversation is a little bit about the things that are important to me, the values that I think are important, the standards that I want to set for the command, about how we treat each other with respect and dignity, how we evaluate people and the content of their character and the quality of their work. Because nothing else matters. At Gerald R. Ford, character counts. You could be the best worker in the world, but you have flawed character, you will not last in that command, nor should you. I'll take a sailor that's got great character and we can build on the work part, but I'll take character over work any day of the week. Because that to me is the culture of the command. That's the foundation that we build. But I ask him a couple of questions, and the two that I really focus on are, why did you join the Navy? And I certainly want to know where they're from, but why did you join the Navy? And what's important to you in life? Notice I said life, not what's important to you in the Navy. I want to know what's important to our sailors in life. Again, because if I know more about them, I can be a better commanding officer, I can set better policies in the command, and I can set the course for the command better. I can build the foundation better. And then at the end of that conversation, we present them with their uniform that now has the Gerald R. Ford patch on the NWU uniform. That's that blue camouflage uniform that we wear. And now they're fully inculcated in the command. And now I know when I walk around the ship, when I see those patches, that's a Ford sailor, and I've talked to them. And I will freely admit, sometimes it gets hard. We've got 1,300 sailors now on our way to 2,600. That's going to take a lot of my bandwidth to remember all those names, but I'm doing my best. It certainly helps when we go hang out in Michigan together, because we brought Chief Simmons and Airman Garrett, two sons of Michigan here, and we've spent the last few days here in Grand Rapids and now in Ann Arbor, so it's been a great visit. But that's kind of how we build that foundation, and I wanted to talk about a couple of other things that we talk about a lot. I told you we talk about character and the core values that we espouse in the Navy of honor, courage, and commitment. We talk about that. I don't spend a lot of time talking about what not to do, because you might find this funny, but I don't like rules as a rule. And I don't, because I'm one of those COs that enforces rules. And if you've ever been in a place that has different standards for different people, nothing will be cancerous to a command than that. If I treat you differently than I treat you, or if I have different policy for male sailors than I do for female sailors, or I do this, that, or the other thing differently, that'll undermine a command terribly. So I don't stand for that. I'm very, very in tune with the command as well. So I spend a lot of time, and I told you my highlight of my day is checking sailors in, but I spend a lot of time on the deck plates talking to sailors, seeing how things are doing, not because I'm spying on anybody, but because I want to know. And I have our crew teach the technology to me. So we've got all those new systems that I talked about. I could read about them in a book. I don't want to read about them in a book. I want you to read about them in a book, and I want you and your junior sailors to now take me and teach me about the dual band radar. Take me up to Wallops Island where they have the shore-based test facility and demonstrate to me how we're standing watch and how we're doing that. And Airman Garrett, I want him to take me down into our aircraft fuel station and show me how the fuel flows. Show me how we purify it. Show me how we clean it. Show me what the maintenance schedule is on the fuel pumps. And you know, he brought his books to study his ratings exams with him on this trip. You know, somebody asked me about metrics. You know, in today's society, we're really big about metrics. Everybody wants to graph something and plot it and, you know, put a dial on it or a needle on it and you know, slice it a million different ways. There's some things that don't really lend themselves to measuring. And then there's the notion, too, that, you know, just because you can measure it, what does that tell you? What good is that? The metrics that I generally get are feedback, they're data points. A data point when an airman apprentice who's been in the Navy for 5 months brings his ratings exam book to study with on a trip back home to Michigan, that's a pretty good data point. That culturally we're creating the right points. You know, I talked about those patches that we put on our uniforms, and they identify us very crystal clear. All of us Gerald R. Ford sailors are very easy to identify. I joke that I can spot a Ford sailor about 2.5 blocks away walking around Newport News. They're that that distinctive. I had a phenomenal pulse point on how that's working. Because the goal was with that to identify Ford sailors proudly. And I'm pretty confident that we walk a little straighter, hold our heads a little bit higher, but also to be kind of a touch point as they're walking around in other places. Because there's a lot of buzz on the waterfront about all the cool technology and all the neat stuff on Ford. And I would like to think that there's a lot of buzz about the culture that we're creating there, which is, to me, more important than the technology. But I had a female sailor check in the other day, and she was a little more senior, so she had a choice to pick where she wanted to go. And she told me that she was in the Navy Exchange, saw a sailor with that patch, started talking to him, was impressed with the sailor, impressed with what they had to say about the command climate and the crew, and immediately volunteered for orders to Gerald R. Ford. That's pretty hard to measure that in a graph or a bar graph, but you know, I get data points like that, that's pretty good. That's kind of what I'm looking for. I had a great opportunity to chat with some midshipmen earlier today. And Joe, it was great to have the opportunity. We talked for an hour and a half, and I think if Joe hadn't pulled the plug, we'd probably still be talking to him and you'd be waiting outside for us to wrap up, because it was a fun conversation. And I told each and every one of them, I wish I could trade spots with them. I love my job, but I'll tell you that their future is so bright in the Navy with so many innovations, new classes of aircraft carrier, joint strike fighter, unmanned aerial vehicles, the new submarine design, the next generation of the Ohio class replacement on the drawing boards. There is an exciting bunch of things going on in the Navy. But we talked a lot about leadership, and I think one of them talked to me about what motivates me. And I want to share a little bit about that with you, because what motivates people interests me. And I am very intrigued by what motivates the sailors on board Gerald R. Ford. And we're working tirelessly. I say we, because it is we. It's not just me. But we're working, I think, tirelessly to create self-motivated sailors or internally motivated sailors. And if you think about that for a second, what motivates you, if it's your paycheck, I would argue that that's external motivation. If it is making a difference in the world, making a difference in somebody's life, contributing to somebody, perhaps as an educator, somebody, and seeing that student do their homework, show up ready to go, ready to learn, hard charging, and you creating that spark in that person, if you're an instructor or a teacher, that is inspiring. And if that's what gets your juice going, then that's internal motivation. So what motivates me is internal. We had a young lady checked in from New Orleans, and I will freely admit I have lived a very blessed life in many, many ways, more ways than I can count. I had wonderful parents. My mom, who passed away about 2 years ago, is a wonderful woman. There's not a day that goes by that I don't miss her. My dad's still alive, and I grew up in Western Pennsylvania with great core values: hard work, team sports, education, baled hay, played football, did all this great stuff, and had a loving, supportive family. So I can't relate to some of the stories that I hear from sailors that check in. Well, this young lady from New Orleans, mom's in jail for dealing drugs, doesn't know who her dad is, being raised by a series of different family members as she is being grown up as a young lady. Somewhere in that process, she gets a spark inside her. To quote her, "I've got to get out of here before I'm dead, in jail, or pregnant." And that spark brings her to our doorstep at Gerald R. Ford. And I am so intrigued by sailors that make that decision, because that is a hard decision to break out of an environment like that. And it reminds me of what my greatest responsibility is as commanding officer, and that is to our nation's most precious assets, her sons and daughters. As a steward of that precious asset, when I get a young sailor like that, I will do everything in my power to make her successful. And I start with that command climate, that foundation that we build, that culture of respect and dignity, that culture that, you know what, I don't care what the standard was in New Orleans, the standard is here, that you get evaluated in the content of your character and the quality of your work, period. Notice I didn't mention any of those other labels. I didn't mention gender, skin color, sexual preference. Now, none of that stuff matters to me, because when I look at our crew, I see sailors, and in particular, I see Gerald R. Ford sailors who are treated fairly, with respect and dignity. And if you build that as a base and a foundation, a young lady comes in to the command, and she just doesn't come into the command and go through the motions, she blossoms. And that's exactly what's happening. And in part, the rest of the story to this is interesting to me, because she checked in with me 6 weeks ago. And in the Corps, shortly after she checks in, she comes and she talks to her legal department, and we find out that she fraudulently enlisted, meaning that she lied to the recruiter. That's generally a big deal. You, by all rights, I could have very easily kicked her out of the Navy. And I would argue that if I didn't think her character was worth staying in the Navy or in Gerald R. Ford, that would have been easy and justifiable to do. But I know her from Indoc, and I had her come up to my office, and I talked to her for about 30 minutes, and you can imagine she's an airman recruit, scared to death talking to the captain. She shouldn't be, though. She talked to me for 2 hours just a couple of weeks prior. But we talked, and I wanted to kind of get a glimpse into her character. And she was afraid to tell the recruiter the truth, and told me that the recruiter said, don't say anything about that, because they probably won't take you if you say anything. And she wanted to get out of the environment she was in. So as commanding officer, this is one of the things I absolutely love about my job. When you've been in the Navy for 28 and a half years and you're CO of the nation's newest aircraft carrier in an 06, dang, some folks don't listen to you. So when you write a letter to an admiral and you tell them, Admiral, I know that these are the rules and that, you know, by the letter of the law this should happen, but it's not the right thing to do, that resonates. And I haven't found out the results of that yet, but I wrote that letter to Admiral Shoemaker, and I wrote a rather lengthy handwritten note to him, and I'll see him on Friday and talk to him personally about that case, because it's the right thing to do. You know, we don't get to pick where we're born or what our family's like or what our background's like, but at some point in our lives, we kind of cross a tipping point, I think, where we start to make the decisions for ourselves, where we start to control our own destiny. And I view it as our job to do everything in our power to help people make the right choices. Along those lines, you know, I talk about the changes that we can make in people's lives, which I love. But also, as the CO of Gerald R. Ford, we can make some changes, and that's really why I've stayed in the Navy, is to affect change and to make things better. We've dramatically improved a whole host of things. The barracks where our sailors live is a civilian-run barracks that when our sailors showed up, they couldn't use the washing machines there because the washing machines were so old and rusty that they'd destroy their clothes. And there are no restaurants in there, and if you know anything about Newport News, it's where this berthing is. It's not a very good area. It hasn't been a good area probably for 30 years or more. And it's not really where you want your sailors out and about walking the street trying to find some food. And oh, by the way, there are no restaurants there. And there's no kitchen or messing facility on board either. So your real option is to get in a car, which a lot of our young sailors don't have, to go get food somewhere else. So we improved the kitchen, improved the dishwashers, refrigerators, microwaves, all new. We put in free Wi-Fi. We got our sailors this, if you know anything about some of the allowances and stuff, we get BAS as an allowance that we get for food. We wrote a letter to the Chief of Naval Personnel explaining why our sailors should get two times that, which means about $400 extra a month for those sailors. And these are the youngest sailors in our charge. And every single one of those things we were able to get changed. And if I didn't say free Wi-Fi, I'll say it again, free Wi-Fi. Because what do sailors do they want? They want free Wi-Fi. And we got one of the greatest compliments ever that I've ever gotten, and you know, this is a metric, if you will. We've got a Master Chief in our command in Combat Systems Department, Master Chief Hughes, who when she was a young seaman, she was stationed in that same building, in that same nasty part of town with probably the same washing machines that destroyed their clothes back then. And nobody cared, and they didn't have Wi-Fi, and nobody fixed the kitchen. And her words to me the other day were, you know what, Captain? You've created a sanctuary there. And I don't put that in a graph. I share that with you not because I'm all that. I share that with you because that's how actions reinforce words. You can say things all you want. You can say your sailors are the most important thing in the world. You can say that the sailors are the weapons system. You can say that you care about them. But until you show it, until you demonstrate it, in action, in deed, and results, I would argue that it rings hollow. So I think on Ford, we do that over and over and over again. And everything we do is to build the foundation. And all I have to do is look at the core values of Gerald R. Ford, his life of service, and it's easy. If we can copy that, if we can emulate that, a life of service to the Navy, to his community, to his country, and to his family. What a role model. What a role model as a husband, a father, a statesman, and a sailor. So it is great to be back in Michigan. And, you know, we did talk a little bit about the weather. I don't mind the bad weather, and I, in all sincerity, look forward to coming back. I hope when I come back, my schedule's perhaps not quite as jam-packed as it has been this time, but it has been, I've spoken to more reporters or more groups of people or more radios than I have ever spoken to in my life on this trip. I really have. We have. And we've been all over Grand Rapids, and it is absolutely fantastic to be here. But I'll tell you, every data point, I think, grounds me more in the culture that we want to create on board Gerald R. Ford. We want Gerald R. Ford to be the culture of President Ford. I want it to be the culture of Michigan, the foundation that built him, that turned him into the president that our nation has always wanted. So thank you for the great hospitality. I know it's been cold, but I have never received a warmer welcome anywhere I've been. And I'm more than happy to talk with you as long as you want to talk. I'll answer any question you want to talk about as well, whether it's about the capabilities of the ship, whether it's about my philosophies on leadership or the things in the culture that we're trying to create on board Ford. So. And if I don't like your question, I have advised Chief or Airman Garrett that I might direct them to answer. So they will pay attention. Yes, I think we have one back here first, sir.
Yeah, two questions. Can it get through the new expanded Panama Canal? And second, can it take a conventional torpedo head, you know, the strength of the hull?
I don't know the dimensions of the proposal for the expanded Panama Canal. I'm pretty confident it will because it's being designed for super tankers, but I don't know the draft and the dimensions of that. So I can't really answer that. The current Panama Canal, no, our aircraft carriers won't fit through there. So typically if we've been moving carriers from east to west, we go all the way down around South America. I won't get into the classification level about your second question about torpedo hits, but I will tell you that the objective is to not get hit by a torpedo. Okay? So we spend a lot of time and energy trying to track potential adversaries and subs, and we have a whole bunch of means to do that. The ship's very maneuverable. We have some things that I won't talk about in this forum that can protect us. And I will also tell you that the ship is robustly designed. And I don't know that I really want to go into it too much more than that, but the ship is designed to a standard that far exceeds what is required to float, meaning that it is designed to withstand battle damage. I've gone out to the blasting facility in Erebonia, Virginia, which is an old slate quarry, and I went out there, and this is a pretty neat process. What they do is they have a barge that is configured exactly like the ship in a compartment, and they put components in that barge. Actually, I have several barges, but they put components in there mounted exactly, same component, mounted exactly like it is, and then they put charges in the water and blast it. And I'm here to tell you, the charges that I've seen, enormous. The barge launched out of the water and that sort of thing. It's a very, very rigorous test. We do great testing, great design, and that's about all I want to get into on that.
My father was a sailor in World War II and my grandfather was a CB. Uh-huh. I'm a retired history teacher, and listening to you, I'm almost ready to enlist.
We will take you.
But anyway, my question is that even though life on the Ford sounds fabulous and beautiful and wonderful, we know that even in our national academies, we've had sexual misconduct and scandals surrounding things. How confident are you that your male and female sailors will feel safe in reporting to you and your staff misconduct?
I'm 100% confident of that. And I'll tell you why. Because again, I don't have metrics, but I'll give you a data point. I had a young lady who checked in with me, and during the course of our conversation, told me about a sexual assault that had happened to her 12 years ago that she had never told anybody else in her life. That happened to her 12 years ago while she was in the Navy, from a friend, kind of a date rape kind of a scenario. And the options with something like that are, you know, as commanding officer, it's not just, I'm sorry to hear that, it's not just empathy. I have a responsibility to that. And I took that information after the group meeting. I talked to her, I told her that I had to report that. We reported that. She spoke with the Naval Criminal Investigative Service, and she has elected not to pursue that. But we pulled that through the whole thing. And I feel very comfortable that our sailors will report those things. I feel very comfortable that our sailors will prevent those things. Because the real challenge is with sexual assault, and this is not a problem isolated to the Navy by any stretch. I mean, we're here at the University of Michigan. This is a problem on college campuses. It is a problem in high schools. It is a problem in life. But I think that when you build the right foundation in a crew, where you treat people with respect and dignity, and I talk to every sailor, what I didn't tell you I didn't talk about, is I talk to every sailor about sexual assault. So that 2-hour-plus conversation, I spent at least 20 minutes talking about my philosophy on that. And my philosophy is, I don't want to deal with sexual assault, I want to prevent sexual assault. And we have some spectacular tools in the command. First and foremost is the culture that we create. A culture that our most junior sailor, when he overhears an inappropriate comment from a sailor saying something perhaps about another sailor, that he has the moral courage to speak up and immediately correct that on the spot. If he doesn't do that, what has he just done? He's just lowered the bar. He's just lowered the standard and kind of said, hey, it's okay to do that in front of me. And if you haven't gathered, I'm passionate about this topic, and I'll talk to you about this all night if you want, because I am adamant about not just preventing it, eliminating it. So it starts with the culture that we create in the command. We have some other tools in the command that are superb. We have a group called Coalition of Sailors Against Destructive Decisions. If you think about almost every sexual assault, there's a bunch of decisions that are made that ends in a sexual assault. And I don't pin any of those decisions on anybody. That is not ever intended to assign blame. That just is that there are decisions. And in life, some decisions are better than others. And the way you defeat those destructive decisions, the way we approach it, is young sailors, peer-to-peer, a group that focuses on good, healthy activities, good decision-making, looking out for each other like brothers and sisters, not sexual conquests. We have another program that's called CIMEO, which is Command Managed Equal Opportunity, and the partner to that is the command assessment team. So I have two entities or organizations inside the command that do surveys. And in our command, we do spot surveys. So if you can imagine being in a large organization and somebody from my CIMEO team comes down and they grab you and they sit you down and they talk to you for about 5 or 10 minutes, they ask you a few questions, they take some notes, and they bring you back to the workplace and they go and they get somebody else. And I call these micro surveys. So I pulse the command a whole host of ways, a bunch of different times, and I might just find those cracks in the foundation of the culture of the command, before they turn into a sexual assault. And then probably the best tool we have is a program called Sexual Assault Prevention Response Victims Advocates. It's a mouthful. We call them SAPR VAs. Those are the folks that are trained, week-long school, recurring training, monthly training, to respond to sexual assaults. Notice I said I don't want to respond to a sexual assault, I want to prevent them. Every one of those sailors that wants to do that sits down with me for about an hour. We have a one-on-one conversation. I want to know what their motivation is. I want to know why they want to do it. And I want to talk to them about preventing sexual assault and eliminating it. And you do that by focusing way left of the event. So if you treat the little stuff, if you do not tolerate sexism, inappropriate comments, dirty jokes, innuendo to creep into the workplace, that's how you prevent sexual assault. It's that little stuff. Because I am convinced that there's a slippery slope that kind of starts with sexist behavior and comments and jokes and perhaps an inappropriate poster or walking on the ship and seeing somebody who's maybe spray painted a phallus on a ship under construction. And I say that because I saw that. And I went and talked to the superintendent of construction, and it took him about 5 minutes to fix that. That's it. So the shipyard's all over that. They're not going to stand for it either. But you focus on that and you eliminate it by all the way to the left. You know, you don't ever have any sexual harassment because you don't have any sexism. And if you don't have any sexual harassment, you essentially eliminate your chance of sexual assault. And if you know anything about Heinrich's triangle, if anybody, any mathematicians or statisticians in here, Heinrich was a guy, and I learned this at nuclear power school, so I'm getting too deep on you, let me know. But Heinrich was a guy that was looking at safety statistics, and he found that you could draw an empirical analysis between the incidence of low-level events to the likelihood of a major event. So if you measure things for, say, low-level safety violations, and if you have a rigorous process in there where you are pulsing and sampling and developing metrics and checking, and if you have a whole lot of low-level stuff, guess what? You probably are going to or do have some mid-level stuff, and the more of that, the wider the base of the pyramid, the higher the likelihood of a pinnacle event, which from my approach to this is, the more instances of sexism, sexual harassment, or inappropriate behavior you have, the greater the likelihood you'll have sexual assault. So I'm all over this. This command right now has 45 of those sappers, 45 sailors have sat down with me for a one-on-one, and we're all in. And you know, there's no limit to the number of those folks that we can have. The training's free. My goal is that I have no goal, but anybody who wants to be a sapper at Gerald R. Ford will be a sapper. They will talk to me. And I very much understand the impact of sexual assault to families because I have friends, I have shipmates, and I have peers that have been victims. It's very personal to me. I'm doing everything in my power to eliminate it, not prevent it, eliminate it. Sure. So anybody else want to ask about that? I'll talk about that for a while. Okay. That's a good question. I have shared that model with my leadership. I've spoken to it in a few public fora before. I'm passionate about it, but you know, my focus is really where I'm at. I got to really worry about Gerald R. Ford. And perhaps someday in another position or another job, I'll have a bigger aperture. But I'm all in on this, and I'm pretty convinced we're on the right path with it. So, yes, sir.
I read your resume, and it's quite impressive.
Thank
first
you.
An aviator, and then you learned to control nuclear power, which a friend of mine does that or did that. And now, for the last half dozen years, you're a surface warfare officer, so you're wearing a lot of hats. Admiral Spruance was just a surface warfare officer in World War II, and now you are all of those rolled into one. What percentage of carrier captains are all of those? And the other question is, a young man who's very impressive graduated from the ROTC here, Naval ROTC, 10 years ago, went into submarines and found the culture not to his liking. He couldn't make any changes, even using electronic forms instead of paper. He finally went to a different branch of the Navy where he's doing just fine now. But how have you been able to make your changes? Obviously, it's political, but you've been very successful at it. So how have you done that?
I love that question. And sometimes we refer to, you know, chucking a softball question. That's a beach ball. That's right in my wheelhouse. I love to talk about that. First, I'll tell you about carrier COs. All carrier COs by law have to be aviators. We all have to be nuclear trained. So the amount of training that goes into getting me where I'm at today is really 28 and a half years of training. 20 years as an aviator, about 2 years as nuke school, about 2 years as the executive officer on a carrier, about 2 years as the commanding officer of a deep draft ship, in my case, the Gunston Hall, and now here. So that's a pretty robust level of training. I would tell you it makes us, this training level that we have, ideally suited for command of carriers, that we do know all those major warfare areas so well. As far as the young man that, or I presume a young man, because he was a submarine, who found the culture not to his liking. Well, I'll tell you about another young man a few years back who thought he was just gonna serve the Navy for 5 years and get out. And this is me that I'm talking, if you didn't figure that out. I thought that I was gonna just do my time and get out, and I started this list of reasons to get out and reasons to stay. And my list of reasons to stay was very easy. It was camaraderie, pride, and service, and flying. And my list of reasons to go was long and distinguished. It filled up the back sheet of a paper, and I actually flipped over my reasons to stay, and I was working up from the bottom. And I realized, and I don't make decisions lightly, by the way, I try to think them through as best I can. So I realized as I'm looking at that list of reasons to go, what would happen to those reasons to go if I got out? Would anybody fix them? No. I would just hand it over here and say, hey, will you guys fix this? Because I'm getting out. It's not my problem anymore. And I realized if I was going to stay in, I was going to stay in to affect change, to make a difference and to make it better. And I will offer to you, and I would have offered to this young man who was in that environment, that's a hard and mature decision at the same time to make as a young lieutenant, because your ability to affect change as a lieutenant is pretty limited, right? That was 23 years ago, okay? That was me 23 years ago. It took me 23 more years to get to a point where I think I can effectively make change, I think real change, lasting change that impacts and makes a difference in people's lives. And I think I'm also at a point in my career in the Navy that when I do write a letter to the Chief of Naval Personnel or to Commander Naval Air Forces, that it's well-researched, that they listen to it, I make a good point, and that they will more than likely say yes if I can articulate the point well enough. And my challenge then becomes, how well can I articulate it? And that's an important aspect. If I just say, hey, this is a good idea in an email, maybe that's not the right way. So I write formal letters to flag officers all the time. And I don't just sit back in my office and have bright ideas. I think we're trying very hard to create that culture within the leadership and in the department that if something's broke, if something doesn't work, in particular, perhaps somebody doesn't want to fund training that I think we need. I tell them, you know how this is going to work. You're either going to fund it or I'm going to go talk to the admiral and tell him why I need this training. And then you're going to have to go explain to him why you don't agree that the commanding officer who's got the best seat of anyone as far as what our training requirements are, you know how this is going to play out. So if you want to go that path, go right ahead. But I'm going to go call the admiral the second this doesn't work my way. And I kind of like that. And I don't mean that in a bellicose way or anything or a bullying way. I mean that is that at Gerald R. Ford, there's nobody in the Navy that has a better perspective on the training that we require for the systems that we have or the culture that we're creating. And I wouldn't ask for it if we didn't need it. I mean, I'm a steward of the taxpayers' dollars. I mean, I would not ask for training that I didn't think, and I wouldn't get it too early to need, and I wouldn't get too much of it. So I think we're judicious with that. But back to your question, hard decision to make as a junior officer, but you can't fix it if you're not there. And I think that holds in any organization. In my case, it happens to be the Navy, but if you're in another organization, you know, you don't like the way the organization is, well, you can quit, or you can stay there and be an instrument for change. I chose the latter.
He found a different branch of the Navy. He became an aide to an admiral, and he's doing just fine, still in the Navy.
Mm-hmm. Has he gone on to aviation community by any chance? Okay.
In a sense.
So he's working for an aviator as an admiral, right?
The planes that fly along coastlines.
Oh, okay, those ones, yeah, okay.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
And thank you for what you're doing.
You're welcome.
It's a tremendous responsibility. I'm Commander Summerat. I've recently retired. I'm a technology guy.
Okay.
So I'm particularly excited about the technology in the Gerald R. Ford and the fact that it was designed to actually evolve with the technology.
Absolutely.
I went to the christening of the USS Detroit a couple weeks ago, and I coined that as the closest thing to Star Wars that we have. Uh-huh. But I'm sure you'll exceed that. Because I know this is a leap in tech in capability from the George W. Bush, and so I'm pretty excited about it. Wanted to comment on the questions about Sapper. Mm-hmm. Just 2 years ago, when I retired, every sailor went through 16 hours of Sapper training. We had a zero tolerance on that, and I know that's throughout the Navy. So, yeah, I do believe the civilian community could probably learn a lot about what the Navy is doing and how that might work, because it is a huge problem on college campuses. My question really centers around AMOL, and I wish you a lot of success on it. Mm-hmm. I know you're going through testing that out. You may have already covered it, mm-hmm. but I'd be interested in what kind of preparations you're taking to prepare for this test of a brand new technology.
You're talking about EMALS, the Electromagnetic Aircraft Launching yes. System? Yeah, great system. We have a system up in Lakehurst right now that is being tested and has been kind of a little bit more of a developmental, but it's installed. And I've been up there and I've seen it launch an aircraft. We've got over 1,000 catapults of real aircraft. Granted, it's on a runway. It's not on a ship yet. Well, it's on, but we haven't operated on the ship yet. The test pilots will tell you that the linear acceleration of those catapults is fantastic. It's very, very smooth. When we run all the data and we get enough runtime, we're going to find out that it's easier on our aircraft, and we buy back some service life on our aircraft, both on the launching side and on the landing side. So that's a plus. The installation process has gone very well. We're well ahead of schedule. When I say well ahead of schedule, months ahead of schedule with EMALS testing. I was just on board the ship last week conducting some of the EMALS testing myself, so I won't get too much into the technical aspect. I can talk to you later about that if you'd like, but basically controlling EMALS myself from a maintenance workstation, walking around inspecting some of the equipment as we energize it for the first time, and I think we're on a very, very good path with EMALS. The challenge really with EMALS to me is not so much the technology as it is the training. And this holds true for a whole host of systems. So if you're into technology, we're out in front of the Navy's training program for almost all these systems. So, and I'll give you an example. This is kind of the model example. And I offer this as the model because reactor department was manned fuller and bigger earlier because of the testing and the construction process than the other departments. So they were out front. They were the first ones doing this. But when you go to nuclear power school, you spend about 2 years learning about the principles of nuclear operations. You learn about all of the procedures and practices to operate the training facilities that we have in Charleston. So old retired submarine, or up in New York where there's a plant that's in a building. And you learn all those practices and procedures. But none of that teaches us about the A-1B reactors, the new reactors on board Gerald R. Ford. It's great theory. It's, you know, the principles are the same, but it's not specific to our plant. So when our folks came here, what did we do? We created our own training. Now, we had some help with other people, and we created what we called School of the Ship, where we essentially taught, in Navy terms, an A school. So a school all about the specifics of our plant that built on those fundamentals, built on the principles of nuclear power, and applied it to our ship. That's a great model. So what we've done is we've taken that model, and now our air department has kind of one-upped the nukes. They've created their, no kidding, their own A school for how we operate EMALS and AAG. Created it. The Navy has got schools, commands, and others that are supposed to do that sort of thing. But how foolish would we be if we just sat around and waited for somebody else to do it? We've got the capacity. We've got the ability to do it. We've got the smartest sailors in the Navy on these systems. We are doing that. today. And we've also got a regular drumbeat about sending folks out to the manufacturers to get training. EMALS is made by a company called General Atomics, headquartered in Rancho Bernardo near San Diego. I've been out there a couple times. They've got a simulator that emulates and simulates the logic and the software between all four catapults and the launching sequence about how that goes. We just had 16 of our sailors out there for 2 weeks. I went out for the graduation ceremony, and it was fantastic. It's training that we created in coordination with the manufacturer. Think about that for a second, because that's unique. Normally, you get sailors that show up at your ship that are fully trained, ready to go, ready to operate. In the case of EMALS and many of the systems that we have on board the ship, we are pushing the rope. We are creating the training environments. We are directly liaison with the manufacturers. We're having the engineers and the manufacturers come to us. We're going to them. Chief Simmons is working on our dual band radar. He's been up to Wallops Island, where there's a shore-based test facility. And they don't have a complete ship set up there, but they've got one of the arrays. We were just up there last week, I think, doing air traffic control work and operating on live flying targets. We're getting every little nuance of training we can through different means, well out in front of the Navy Schoolhouse solution. So I don't know if that answers your question, but that's what we're targeting, is the training. And the part that is the challenge with much of that is what we call ILS, Integrated Logistics Support. Integrated Logistics Support is the technical manual, the owner's manual, if you will. It's the operating procedures, so how do you turn it off, how do you operate it? It's the preventive maintenance procedures, and embedded in all that is the stuff that tells you what kind of personal protective equipment you needed to use when you maintain it, what kind of lubricants and pieces and parts you need to maintain it. All that stuff is part of that as well. So we've been very closely working with manufacturers to develop that.
All right. Is the incorporating new technology and the more advanced systems going to change the makeup of the crew and the people on board? And how do you think that will impact like the day-to-day operations of the ship in the field?
Fantastic question. The question is how that changes the dynamic in the Navy and the dynamic in the ship. What it really does is it focuses us to a much more technologically advanced Navy. So if you think of kind of paradigm shifts in the past, some of our folks have worked on much more mechanical systems or hydraulic systems, and now everything is electronic. So ITs, information technologies, or ICMEN, which control networks, are in very, very high demand. So we're a very network-centric ship. We rely on much more technical level knowledge, and there are very few things, there are a lot fewer things that require a wrench and many more things that require a computer and electronic computer diagnostic tools to operate and maintain those. So that's the shift that I see there. And there's another aspect that makes your question incredibly astute. So if you take 700 sailors off the ship and you still got a whole bunch of stuff that you got to maintain on board that ship, doesn't that make every single sailor in that command more valuable, more precious to the command? Right, from a philosophical point of view, if I have 700 fewer sailors, I have what I refer to as the term that we've coined, is the training density on the remaining sailors is higher. Whereas in the past, a sailor might have one specific skill set. Now, they're going to have two or three specific technical skill sets. That's a different way of looking at business. And when I ask for training solutions, I'm all over that aspect with folks that, you know, I may have a sailor that I have to send to several different areas or schools, whereas before I would send one or two sailors to this one, one or two to this, one or two to that, and you never stack those trainings up. That causes a few things. One is your sailors are more valuable, so you better take better care of them, right? The other is your sailors are more valuable, so you better not lose them, right? I mean, if somebody falls down a ladder or gets sick or has to go on emergency leave, I better have redundancy built into that program. So if you're ever one deep in something, right, if you only have one person that can do the one thing that needs to operate the dual band radar, F, right, you have failed. Because what's going to happen? Sure enough, that person is going to trip and fall down a ladder and they're going to get heloed off the ship or something. And then what do you do? nothing. The thing breaks and you don't do anything. So my opinion is if somebody tells me I need one of anything, no, I need three. And that way I know that we're not ever going to get in that problem. But I think that's a very, very deep question. How old are you? 21. Very, very astute about the leadership and the aspect of how you build a training culture and the value of the people that have the critical skills that you need to operate the world's most technologically advanced warship. You said what that was the last. I'd talk to you all night. I love talking about the crew and things, but if that was in fact the last, I guess that was the last. So, all right. Well, thank you.